Hello guys and welcome to my new video. So today I decided to do a Resto Druid guide for patch 7.3. Now, why am I doing a guide for Resto Druids when there is no really any changes being made for Druid class themselves in patch 7.3? I'm doing this basically because I think that a lot of my previous guides have kind of been outdated and some of the information can be updated to actually provide a bit more in detail depth to the Resto Druid class itself. So I'm going to be doing a guide for 7.3 and most likely a 7.35 if there are any Druid changes coming before the Antorus raid. So as a Resto Druid in 7.3, what kind of talents and gear should you be using? So there is actually a big discussion. There's actually a lot of people are unhappy about how tier 20 turned out. A lot of people are unhappy how tier 19 is super super strong, which meant that there is two divisions of tiers in 7.3 and in 7.25. a lot of people are using either four set tier 19. As you can see here, I'm actually using tier 19 four set, and a lot of people are either using, like I do, I also have an additional set, 4 set tier 20 with 2 set tier 19. So there are two builds at the moment that are available, and there's a lot of discussion about which one's better for which fight, how many item levels my tier 20 have to be in order to be better than tier 19. So your talent choices are kind of going to be based on the tiers that you're currently equipped. Let's say you have a high level tier 19, which I do, 920, 915 with a socket. Tier 19, cookie builder talent choice would be something along the lines of this. You'll be running Scenario Ward, Displacer Beast, Guardian Affinity, Typhoon Cultivation, Germination, and Flourish. So this is the cookie builder build for tier 19. The big issues here is tier 90 talents. Most of the time people choose between Germination and Spring Blossoms. With tier 19 you most likely will be just running Germination because of how tier 19 with the legendary shoulders provides amazing synergy for your rejuvenation. So if you have high level tier 19, you have the legendary shoulders, most likely you'll be running Darkmoon Deck Promises for the increased mana. You'll be running this talent build and you'll be spamming rejuvenations all day long and every day. This is the whole build, basically just spam rejuves on everyone. And through the use of Darkmoon Deck Promises, mana won't be crazy issue. Now, if you don't have a high item level tier 19, or if you have tier 20 that's actually insanely high item level, general rule, I can't really tell you when to upgrade tier 19 over tier 20. You should be using spreadsheets. Tori spreadsheet actually has a specific section where you input your tier 19 values and you input your tier 20 values, and it tell you whether it's an upgrade or not. The general consensus is that if your tier 20 is around 20 item levels higher each piece, so I have tier 19 920, if I have tier 20 chest piece that's around 950 or 940, I should be using tier 20 for specific fights with tier 20 works well. Now, what are the exact specific fights with tier 20 actually works? Okay, so if your tier 20 is around 20 item levels higher than your tier 19, you should be using tier 20 for fights like Sisters of the Moon, Desolate Host inside the Spirit Realm, most likely Maidens of Vigilance. These three fights are clear. Sisters of the Moon, Maidens of Vigilance, Desolate Host. These three fights are clear winners with tier 20, most likely will outperform your tier 19. Now, if your tier 20 item level is 30 item levels greater than your tier 19, so we're talking about a huge item level upgrade, you most likely will want to use tier 20 for every fight. This is a general idea about tier 20. You should be using spreadsheet, and I'll link to the spreadsheet and all of the good stuff in the description below to actually really figure out what's better for you. But that is like a general idea of where you should be going. Now, like I said, I have my tier 20 build that I use on specific fights because it is not a 30 item level upgrade. But with tier 20, what kind of talent builds are you going to be running? So the talent build is going to change a little bit. First of all, scenario word most likely will be swapped for prosperity. Why is that? Because with tier 20, your legendary choices are going to change. You no longer will want the legendary shoulders. Your legendary shoulders become much, much weaker without tier 19. You probably will want to swap into the Soul of the Archdruid legendary, most likely. It does change your game style a little bit. Valance continues to be a really, really good legendary and most likely used for any tier set build. So, because of how tier 20 works, tier 24 set or 2 set reduces the cooldown of Swiftman, and every time you Swiftman, your efflorescence healing is increased by 200% for 10 seconds, so therefore having more Swiftmans is really good. Prosperity now is not the best talent choice, it doesn't really give you 2 charges. What it allows you to do is store up those 2 charges. So you can use Swiftman once every, let's say, 30 seconds, if you actually heal someone 100% HP. You'll have a 30 second cooldown, but you'll have a charge, 1 charge left over, and your other charge will be coming back. So if you don't use Swiftman on cooldown, if you actually save it up for those oh my god moments, I need the Swiftman, I need to make sure the efflorescence is down. If you don't use it on cooldown, Prosperity is actually a very, very decent choice. So you'll be running most likely Prosperity, Displacer Beast, Guardian Affinity. When I say Guardian Affinity, to be completely honest, you can choose any of these. I choose between Balance Affinity and Guardian Affinity. Balance Affinity increases the range, and some fights the range is really good because I don't really need survivability that much. Now, Guardian Affinity, Typhoon, Cultivation is usually the choice. Now you see I have Soul of the Forest because I'm using the ring. It comes down there automatically. Now, Germination, Flourish. Flourish is going to be here no matter what. Flourish is the best talent choice for tier 100. For tier 90, you'll be with tier 20, you'll be swapping between Spring Blossoms and Germination and even possibly Inner Peace. Now, what does that actually mean? With tier 19, Germination was probably your go-to choice. With tier 20, you'll be using Germination for fights. With Spring Blossoms, it's just your efflorescence is not going to be great, or these people are not going to be standing in it. Like I said, tier 20 or Germination, Garrote is a great Germination fight. There is dots. You'll be using Germination where there is a continuous dot, e.g. Garrote, kill Jaden. There is a dot for like 20 seconds or something. Germination is amazing for these fights. Demonic Inquisition, most likely Germination can be used really well. Same with Hajitan. Hajitan you can get away with Spring Blossoms as well. Sister of the Moon is where you will kind of want to start using Spring Blossoms. Mr. Sajin, you will not want to be using Spring Blossoms for this, you will want to use Germination. Desolate Host is where both can work, Spring Blossoms or Germination. Maidens, both of them can work. Fallen Avatar, most likely only Germination is going to be your go-to talent here. And Kil'jaeden, like I said, a dot that is placed on targets for 20 seconds plus Germination is king in these kind of situations. So, even with tier 20, you will want to be using Germination. It's not going to be like, oh, I'm using tier 20, Germination is terrible. No, you'll still want to be using Germination on specific fights, and you'll still be wanting to use Spring Blossom on fights with it stacked up. Now, an interesting fact is that, at least for me personally, I use Spring Blossoms as a way to save mana, because with Germination, I tend to go crazy and I just rejuvenate everyone. Like, I'm spending a lot of mana. So for fights like Sisters, where the fight can last up to 9 minutes, for fights like even Kil'jaeden and things like that, it depends. I wouldn't really use Spring Blossoms for Kil'jaeden, but for Sisters of the Moon, Spring Blossoms, or even Desolate Host, where mana can actually be an issue if your DPS is low, Spring Blossoms will tend to save mana for me, purely for the fact that I won't be spamming double rejuvenations on everyone. So that's a personal choice, but I find the Spring Blossoms to be, in a way, a big mana saver for me. Now, these are the talents for tier 19, these are talents for tier 20. Hopefully this cleared up some of the talent choices. You don't have to go Spring Blossoms for tier 20, but with tier 19, Germination usually will become a much better talent choice. So now let's go to stat priority. Now this is where it gets very, very interesting. For stat priority for Resto Druids, I think Resto Druids are probably the only class in the whole game, correct me if I'm wrong in the comments, that each stat is almost equal in value. This is like your crit, haste, massive, versatility are going to rank very close to each other in raid scenarios. Which means any piece of leather gear can count as biz. You can roll on any piece of leather gear as a resto druid and say, these are my biz stats. Now, I don't think there is any class like that in the game right now, which it's a good and a bad thing because it's going to... Well, it's probably mainly the good thing because item level most of the time will be the king. So any piece that has higher item level most likely will be using it over any other piece. Like I said, crit, haste, mastery, versatility are very equal in stat weights. Item level is king. There are a couple of choices that your item level, that your stat priority will change. Mastery is considered a progression stat. The more damage the people take, the better mastery becomes. Mastery also works off cultivation, which means the person has to go below 60% HP. It works off spring blossoms or germination, which means basically if you tend to pick inner peace, your mastery will fall, mainly to the fact because of how mastery works. The more hots you have on a person, the more healing you'll do on that specific person. So if I have my spring blossoms hot, if I have my rejuvenation hot, you can see here, and if I fall below 60% HP and I get cultivation hot, I am doing a massive amount of healing on myself. So if you don't pick into these talents, if you tend to go inner peace, which I probably wouldn't recommend, at least there's a very specific fight where you should be using it, but if you go with this talent choice, your mastery is gonna plummet. Your mastery is gonna be really, like, probably gonna become one of the worst stats that you can do if you tend to go with something like this. So, but the cookie builder talent choice is cultivation, is germination, or spring blossom. So most of the time, mastery will be really, really good. Another consideration, with tier 19, because of tier 19 gives you free rejuvenation once in a while, mastery actually becomes a little, most of the time, you need to really use specials for this, but most of the time, mastery will rank higher than it will rank with tier 20. With tier 20, I am personally seeing my crit tends to be a really good stat, not above, not really ahead of everyone else, but just a little bit higher than it is with tier 19. And with tier 20, I'm seeing that my mastery is a bit lower, but it still seems that all of the stats are very, very, very close together. Item level is still king. Now, what you should be using 100% is using Leaf's Resto Juice stat weights. It's a weak core, you can see right now. You'll be like, Matskins, what are you talking about? It's telling me like 0000. Install this weak core, it'll show up like this. Go to a fight, let's say you go to Mythic Garrote or Normal Garrote or Kil'jaeden or whatever. You're picking specific talent choices, you're going with Cookie Builders, Cultivation, Germination, Flourish. You're going with 3 healers in a 20-man raid. Finish the boss, after the boss is over, you will see stat weights. Now, those stat weights will take into account your talent choices, the amount of healing there was, how your cultivation did, basically how much damage people were taking. It will take all of that into consideration and it'll give you the best stats. What it'll mean is basically one of these in crit, haste, mastery, versatility will show up as 1. If it shows up as 1, that means it's your number 1 stat for that specific fight. So you can see, like, you can go to Garrote and say, like, I'm gonna go and test out incarnation and inner peace build, and you're gonna be using your Trunks and you're gonna be using your trees, you're gonna be spamming your rejuvenation, you're gonna have 3 healers, and you most likely at the end of the fight you will see that your mastery is gonna be your other stat is gonna be number 1. Your mastery is not gonna be there. You're gonna see, like, let's say for example you see your crit as being number 1 and you see your mastery is being 0.6 and your haste being 0.8 and your versatility being 0.8. Which means crit is number 1, haste, versatility are very close together, and your mastery is the lowest. So you can see that for that specific fight, with the specific tier that you're using, with the talents that you're using, And with the healing setup that you're going with, you are getting these specific stats. So there is a tool available like this, and you'll be a fool not to be taking advantage of the tool like that. Because Leaf did a really, really good job on this, and I don't think any other classes actually have something like that. So install WeCourse, install this stat weight priority tool. Now, before I'm rambling on too much, let's go to Relics. So Relic choices, most of the time, the generic rule for this is that your Persistence Relic, which increases your rejuvenation by 1 second, is going to be your number one choice. After that, you have your Knowledge of the Ancients, which increases your mana rejuvenation by 2%. Then you most likely will have Growth Walker, then Essence of Nothersill. It'll be something like this. This is generic. And somewhere in between there, you will have Eternal Restoration, which is the new relic. Increases the duration of Essence of Gnir by 1 second. It's really, really hard to calculate this relic because you have to use a spreadsheet to calculate it fully. If you don't have a spreadsheet, you're guessing. Think about this. You go to Mistress Sojin, where there is, first of all, base duration of Essence of Gnir is around 12 seconds. You go to Mistress Sojin. There is damage, the damage patterns in Mistress Sojin is around, like, you get damage for about 6 seconds, and then everyone tops them up. If you have good healers, the raid is topped up, and then the damage comes in for 6 seconds again. Popping Essence of Gnir, which is 12 seconds, you're going to be wasting a lot of that duration because people are going to be topped up. So having an extra 1 second is going to be absolutely zero usefulness. Now, you go to a fight like Maidens, where there's continuous damage. You go to a fight to like Desolate Host, where there's a lot of damage coming in, or you have like 1 minute damage patterns every 2 minutes. AoE damage will last for a minute. Your essence, you'll be wanting more than 1 second on Essence of Gnir. So it's really hard to calculate Essence of Eternal Restoration relic. You should be using spreadsheet. You can see my right now. You can see my I've been using the spreadsheet, and you can see my values, which are really, really different to what I just said that the generic values for relics is. For me, persistence is still number one. But you can see that for me, Essence of Nodrosil is second. That's because I used two specific fights for my simulation. I used a fight, Desolate Host, Spirit Realms, and I used Sisters of the Moon. Both fights were used tier 20. Both fights where my Efflorescence did around 15 to 20% of healing. And because my Efflorescence was one of my top heals, my relic, Essence of Nodrosil, which increases healing done by Efflorescence, ranked as the second best relic. So you should really be using spreadsheets if you have the choice. The general idea is persistence is numero uno, mana, knowledge of the agents is good, grow walker is very good, it's plus one. It's most of the time is persistence plus three, knowledge of the agents plus one, then it's grow walker, then it's essence on the seal, and most likely somewhere there eternal restoration. Now, to know the exact stat values, use Tori spreadsheet. It's really, really good. It gives you the exact values for your relics and other really, really good stuff. Now, let's move on to the legendaries. The legendary choices for a raiding Resto Druid there's quite a few legendaries that can be used, mixed and matched, but the default legendaries, let's actually go by tier. So tier 19. For tier 19, you won't be running tier 19 4 set without the legendary shoulders. If you don't have the legendary shoulders, most likely you have to give up on tier 19 4 set. You can get away with it, but the legendary shoulders provide a huge, huge boost for your tier 19. Valens by itself is one of the biz legendaries, so you'll be using that no matter what. So shoulders, Valens, really, really good combo for tier 19. For tier 20, you most likely will be sticking to Valens, and you most likely will be using Soul of the Archdruid, which you gain Soul of the Forest buff. Now, we'll cover that a bit later, but most likely be using the ring. Now, if you don't have any of these legendaries and you're wondering which one's better, which one's good, Prydas is a very good option. Prydas is probably top 3, top 4 legendaries. So, these are the really good legendaries. Prydas is very, very good. The Dark Titan's Advice is actually very, very good. Life Bloom's final healing is increased by 200%. I am seeing more and more Resto Druids using this over with tier 19. With tier 19, most likely to be using the shoulders. And a lot of the rest of Jutes are swapping their Valens to actually use this for specific fights with their, like Mr. Sejin, where there's more tank damage and rest of Jutes can't really snipe with the healers. I'm seeing a lot of rest of Jutes going with the Dark Tyrant's Advice. It's a very, it's one of the top tier legendaries. So top tier legendaries, Pridus, the Belt, Soul of the Archdruid, Soul of the Archdruid if you have tier 20, Valens if you have tier 20 of tier 19. These are one of the best legendaries you can see right now. Like I said, Shoulders with tier 19 only. Shoulders with tier 19 only most of the time. Now, Chameleon Song in itself has a use as well. I'll be using this for Mythic Maidens, just purely for the fact because if the proc happens in a fight with this continuous damage, the proc will not really be wasted. It's using a deck system where no matter what, you will get procs. It depends just where you get the procs. Like out of 20 casts, you might get 3 procs, and those 3 procs can happen anywhere, if you know what I mean. So it really, a lot of the legends can be actually used, but like I said, Pridus, Darkmoon's, the Belt, Shoulders with tier 19, Soul of the Archdruid, and Valens are probably going to be your best choice legendaries for this patch. Now before I'm gonna end the guide, I'm just gonna show a little gameplay video. So the big change with tier 20, with tier 19 you're just gonna be, you're memeing around with your rejuvenations, just placing double, okay, I'm not actually happy here, you'll be just placing your double rejuvenations and memeing around all the time. I actually seen top ranking logs where people actually almost ignored life bloom and efflorescence, and then they just went hardcore rejuvenation spam and people did really well. So it just shows you that with the tier 19 spec, you can just go brainless, mindless rejuvenation spam and actually still do really well. I don't recommend that. I still feel that you should be making sure that your light bloom is up, making sure your efflorescence is up, making sure your scenario ward is up 100% of the time, or as close to 100% of the time as possible. Scenario ward on cool, scenario ward on cooldown with tier 19. Don't just use it when a tank takes damage, use it at all times as possible. Now with tier 20, the gameplay changes a lot more. You're gonna be paying a lot more attention to your efflorescence. Second, if you are using your Soul of the Archdruid ring, your whole game style kind of is going to change a little bit. So think about this: you're going to be using most of the time prosperity with tier 20. Sorry, I wasn't cool down. You most of the time will be using prosperity with tier 20. And this is what you're going to be using. So with the Soul of the Archdruid ring, you need to make sure, really pay attention when you're actually going to Swift Man. You need to make sure your efflorescence is down in a group of people. You need to make sure, because after you press Swift Man, you're going to get Soul of the Forest buff, which lasts about 15 seconds. Your efflorescence is healing by a lot. And you're going to be using your Wild Growth, but you need to make sure that the people are taking damage. So I have 3 seconds left, so I'm going to have to use my Wild Growth. What if there's no damage? So you really need to make sure with this build that your efflorescence is down, people are taking damage in efflorescence, and you should be using Wild Growth as your Soul of the Forest increased modifier. So people should be taking damage. Now, what you should also pay attention to things like, what if you use your Wild Growth before and you see people are taking so much damage right now, you're popping your Swift Mend, and you see your Soul of the Forest buff active, but your Wild Growth is not really, it's only coming off cooldown now. If your Wild Growth was off on cooldown, you're stuck in this limbo mode, because if you press rejuvenation, that's gonna, your Soul of the Forest buff is gonna go to your rejuvenation. If you cast regrowth, your Soul of the Forest buff is going to regrow. So if you're in this, cast Wild Growth, you go on Swift Man, and you kind of have to like either wait for your Wild Growth to come back up, or just cast a Empowered Rejuvenation, or Empowered Regrowth, or just maybe go Healing Touch. So you're stuck in this no man's land with tier 20 and Soul of the Archdruid ring. What you need to remember is that you need to pay a lot of attention to make sure that every time you Swift Mend, you have your Wild Growth available. You have your efflorescence into a group of people. If you don't do that, you're stuck in this kind of, like I said, no man's land, and your HPS, your whole game style, you feel like really, really clunky. You'll be like, this is not, it really kind of deters you from playing the spec if you make mistakes like these. So make sure Swiftmant is all your Swiftmant when it's off cooldown, that your Wild Growth is off cooldown as well. This especially with Soul of the Ice Druid Ring. Well, mainly with Soul of the Ice Druid Ring. So this has been hopefully not too long video for Resto Druids in 7.3. I'll be making a guide for 7.35. If there's any changes for Resto Druids, let me know how you feel about the guide. Let me know how you feel about tier 20, tier 19. I know a lot of people hate the tier 20, but you gotta remember tier 21 for Resto Druids is looking like a passive 11, 12, 13% healing, and you don't have to do anything about it. Just cast your Wild Growth and enjoy the healing meters. So thank you guys for watching this little guide. Let me know how you feel about it in the comments, and I'll see you in my next video.